Hi everyone, welcome to lesson 2. In this lesson, we will start talking about constructions. We regard the structures such as phrases, clauses, and sentences as constructions. Phrases, clauses, and sentences are built out of smaller units according to particular parts. Those smaller units are words. Let's look at the example. The player jumped into the field. Here we have a noun phrase, the player, and a verb phrase, jumped into the field. So this structure is known as a clause. Player is formed by a root play and an inflection er, player. The player is formed by a determiner the and a noun player. Jumped into the field is formed by the verb jump and a prepositional phrase into the field. Into the field on time has two elements, a preposition into, which is the head of this phrase, and a noun phrase, sorry for the mistake, the field. We have, in order to make syntactic analysis, we have to understand certain criteria which are important for the right building of constructions. Speakers and writers need a variety of constructions with different functions to use the language effectively in speaking and writing. Different constructions enable speakers to signal what they are doing with a particular structure, to form different speech acts as assertions, questions, or commands. By the way, speech acts are pieces of speech which express meaning. A speech act can be formed by a single word or by a group of words or a complete text. We have different types of constructions. We are going to begin with a basic division based on the structure of verbs. In the first group, we have copula verbs. Here we have as the main representative of copula verbs the verb be, and also some linking verbs as look, seem, become, appear are known or function as copula verbs. On the other hand, we have non-copula verbs. Those are all ordinary verbs in the language which need of the auxiliary do to form questions and negatives. Another division of construction is known as active and passive. Active constructions focus on the doer of the action. Who is the doer of the action? It is the entity that performs an action. Active verbs are built around transitive. Active constructions are built around transitive or intransitive verbs. If I say Marta bought a car, here I have a transitive construction because the verb buy is transitive. How do you know that the verb is transitive? Because all transitive verbs take a direct object. On the other hand, passive constructions focus on the object, and they can be built only around transitive verbs. Remember that intransitive verbs take complements. Intransitive verbs take objects. Look at the example. A new car was bought by Marta. Here, a new car is in subject position. We can say that a new car is the grammatical subject. Was bought by Marta. And Marta is the agent because even being after the preposition by, Marta is the performer of the action of buying. Also, we can recognize imperative constructions. These constructions do not show an overt subject. For instance, listen to me. Imperative constructions have the quality of referring only to the second person, you. So the understood subject here is always you. You listen to me. But as an imperative, we omit the subject and we say simply, listen to me. Finally, we have the existential construction. It is used to introduce new entities in discourse, and it has the expletive there in subject position. In fact, the word there functions as the subject. So we say, there is a boy in the yard. The expletive there is also used to introduce narratives. Word classes. Word classes or word categories, as they are called in traditional grammar, are nouns, adjectives, verbs, adverbs, prepositions, and so on. Here, it is important, in order to understand what are the functions of word classes, it is important to understand what is denotation. It is the relationship between a given word and the set of entities to which it can be applied. Denotation indicates the basic meaning of a word. Then we can distinguish between words that have denotation, express meanings, and words that have very little or no meaning, that express very little meaning, or sometimes they do not express meaning. For instance, auxiliaries in English do not express meaning. According to denotation, words are divided into two groups: content words and grammatical words. Content words express meaning. They apply to people, things, places, actions, states, properties, and situations. Nouns refer to people and things. Verbs refer to actions. Adjectives refer to properties of characteristics. And adverbs refer to places, reasons, and so forth. On the other hand, grammatical words, which are also called function words, they are used as links to join content words. For instance, the definite and the indefinite articles the and e or en are known as function words. They really do not add much meaning, but they add structure, coherence to the clause. Also, demonstrative adjectives, this, that, these, and those, are known as function words, as determiners, not as pronouns. Auxiliaries are also function words. As I told you before, auxiliaries do not express meaning. For instance, when you translate a sentence in English into Spanish, you don't give any meaning to the auxiliary. So you can recognize auxiliaries as function words. Also, conjunctions and interjections can be known can be recognized within this group. We have some criteria to recognize phrases. We can talk about morphosyntactic criteria. In one part is morphological criteria. We have the syntactic criterion and the semantic criterion. And when we talk about morphosyntactic criteria, we have the morphological part of this criterion. And we talk about inflection. We have two types of suffixes, the two types of affixes. They are derivational and inflectional. To begin with, derivational suffixes create new lexical items, as in, for instance, child is a noun, but childish is an adjective. So we are changing the category of the word from noun to adjective. On the other hand, inflectional suffixes carry grammatical information. For example, the plural of nouns, dog, dogs. Also, the ing form for the participle form of verbs. For instance, work or working. Morphosyntactic criterion, we have put together the morphological and the syntactic aspects because the S might change, the S in nouns, the plural form of nouns, changes the form of the verb in a clause. Now let's go to what's very important for us, the syntactic criterion. A noun can occur in different positions, for instance, left and right in relation to the verb. A noun, syntactically speaking, occurs to the left of a verb when it is functioning as the subject, and it occurs to the right of a verb when it is functioning as the verb with transit, as the object with transitive verbs, and as the complement with intransitive verbs. Also, another criterion is that nouns allow an article to their left, but adjectives do not allow anything but an adverbial to their left. For instance, we say small or very small, but we cannot use any sort of determiner. Also, some nouns can be pluralized, but adjectives cannot. Here, we have to compare with Spanish. Adjectives in English have one single form. On the other hand, adjectives in Spanish express number and gender. Just try to do this and you are going to find that what I'm saying is true. Semantic criterion deals with meaning, dictionary meaning, and speaker's meaning. Dictionary meaning refers to what a English dictionary says about the meaning of each entry in the dictionary. On the other hand, speaker's meaning is the meaning that speakers give to words in actual communication. In fact, it is what speakers do with words. It refers to the principle that when speakers perform speech acts, they also perform actions. When you say to your students, "Close the door, please," you are giving an order and also performing an action, right? Look at the example. The speakers use clauses to ask, to assert, to issue commands, to describe, to narrate, and so on. In the, for asking, they use interrogative structures. For asserting, they use affirmative or negative statements. for issuing commands, they use the imperative structure, and so on. Speech acts. A speech act can be defined as any word or string of words that expresses meaning. Speakers use speech acts to refer, to predicate, to issue commands, and so on. When speakers refer, they refer when they mention an entity. Can be a person, thing, animal, or place. And they predicate when they say something about that person. They say something about that entity. So that is referring and predicating. We will talk about these two things in the next class. God bless you. Thank you.